Most Jews in Israel have a very real and direct connection to the pain of Yom HaZikaron. We've lost friends and we've lost family. And for many, the pain is still so real and the wounds are still open. As this Yom HaZikaron was approaching for me, the faces of many of my fellow soldiers and my friends who have died in the army were flying through my head, and I remembered the uncontrollable weeping at their funerals and how traumatic it was for me on such a fundamental level. And I found myself afraid that if Yom HaZikaron, when it comes, I may break down again. And in some ways, I was even more scared that I wouldn't, because in so many ways, I feel like the sorrow and that pain is my connection to them, my relationship with them. Our sages tell us in Ethics of Our Fathers, Kol ahava shehi tuliya b'davar, batel hadavar batla ahava, v'she'ena tuliya b'davar, ena batla le'olam. Any love that is dependent on something, if you nullify that something, then the love is gone. But if it's not dependent on anything, that love lasts forever. The word in Hebrew for love is ahava, and the root is hav, which means to give. True love is giving unconditionally, without the expectation or the desire for anything in return. And that is why we cry on Yom HaZikaron, because of the true ahava and the mesirut nefesh, the self-sacrifice of all of our soldiers who gave their very lives so we could have ours.
I only understood really what mesirut nefesh was when I enrolled in the Israeli army. I moved to Israel when I was 12 years old. And as soon as I moved here, immediately I started thinking, I'm going to be a soldier. I can't wait. In my entire life, I was waiting, 12, 13, 14, high school. After high school, I spent about 3 years in yeshiva. The entire time, I was preparing myself spiritually to go into the army as a spiritual light, that I'd be able to influence all of the people around me that don't come from the same background that I come from. And I went into the army, and immediately I had my eyes. I wanted to be a commander. There was nothing that I wanted more than that. I woke up earlier than everyone else. I went to sleep later than everyone else. I did everything that I could to rise the ranks in the Israeli army. And Baruch Hashem, within 1 year, I became a class commander. And I had 15 of my own soldiers. And I thought to myself, my goodness, what could I be doing at such a young age that would be better than what I'm doing right now? What would be a greater service to my country, a greater service to my people, a greater service to Hashem? What could I possibly be doing at such a young age that would be better than leading a group of 15 Jewish warriors to defend our biblical and historical homeland? What else could I be doing in my life that would be better for that? I woke up every day shining with excitement, knowing that there was nothing that I could be doing that would be better. I woke up every day energized, excited. It was the happiest time of my life. In September of 2000, the Intifada broke out. My unit, Givati, was based out of the Gaza Strip. And just as it is now, it was then. It was the hotbed of all terror. Day in and day out, we fought and we battled. Ruthless terrorists that want nothing but to destroy us. And it doesn't matter if you're tall, if you're short, if you're a child, if you're old. If you're Jewish, you're dead. And it was our job to put our lives in front of the lives of my family and my friends. We battled every day. Of course, in every battle, there are always casualties. And a soldier in my sister unit was killed. And because of my higher ranking, I was asked to carry his coffin, to carry him to his final resting place. I'd never been to a funeral before. Most of my family were killed in the Holocaust. There are not many Gimpels around anymore. Every Jewish law, every Jewish tradition in the Israeli army are all run by strict Jewish law. And as long as the body is not dead, there need to be two men that stand by that body out of respect. I was chosen to be one of those two men. So for that time, I sat and I recited all of the Tehillim, all of the Psalms that I knew by heart, to give comfort to the soul that was there. The ride from the cemetery house to the cemetery was supposed to be about 20 minutes. It ended up being almost 2 hours. So for 2 hours, I sat in the back of a Jeep with my dead brother, 19 years old, lying at my feet, wrapped in a prayer shawl and a tallit draped with an Israeli flag over him. So for 2 hours, I had to sit and think. For 2 hours, I was asking Hashem, I was like, why? 2,000 years we've been suffering. We've been put through so much. Why do we have to do this? We're finally back in Israel. Can't we finally just live in peace? Can't they leave us alone already? Why is this happening? The doors to the Jeep opened, and the mother of this soldier threw herself on the coffin, screaming the same question, why? In international media, the Israeli soldiers look like these big, husky men, nameless oppressors. In reality, they're 18 years old. They're little boys. They're boys dressed up as Israeli soldiers. Instead of going to college in Israel, you go to the Israeli army. And it doesn't matter if you're dressed up as a soldier or not. When a mother loses her 18-year-old boy, it destroys her. It destroys their entire family. We were ordered not to show any emotion, to do our jobs as professionally as possible, and then to go back to our line of duty. But every time we were at the funeral, I kept on imagining that it wasn't this boy's mother, but it was my mother. It was my father. It was my brothers that were kneeled down right over the grave crying. We were ordered not to cry, but how do you stop tears? I was devastated. I'd never been to a funeral before. I'd never been so close to death. It was probably one of the most traumatic experiences of my life. That was the first funeral. The second week was another funeral. The week after that, there was a third funeral. Now, by the third funeral, I started coming apart. I was just a kid. All of my soldiers were looking to me for answers, and I definitely didn't have any. On the way back home from the third funeral, I opened up my commander's pad, and I wrote a letter to American Jewry. And in a nutshell, I asked them, how do you live with yourselves? How do you live with yourselves knowing that we're here in Israel fighting for your country, fighting for your future, fighting for your redemption? And you're at home watching CNN and watching Friends and Seinfeld? How are you not doing anything to us? This was before any Israel Day parades or any conferences. In the beginning of 2000, no one even knew what was happening in Israel. And we felt like we were all alone. I sent this letter to a couple of Jewish newspapers in the southeast where I came from. And I received back such a response. I received a response from Jews all over America, from non-Jews all over America, all of them saying that they pray for us, all of them saying that they love us, all of them saying that they support us, all of them wishing that they could be there with us. It's not the world's fault that they don't know what to think about Israel or that they think poorly about Israel. They never see the real Israel. They never see our pain. They never see our side of the story. And tonight we want to show the world the real Israel. We want to show the world the Jewish people, a people that has suffered so much. All we want is peace. All we pray for is shalom. All we've ever wanted is to live peacefully in our homeland. Tonight, we want to share our pain with the entire world. We want to share our sadness with you because those who cry with Israel will inevitably celebrate with us. We're on a one-track way to redemption, and all of these obstacles that are before us are nothing compared to our beautiful history of 2,000 years. We're on a track to redemption, and there'll be forces that try to stop us. But the Jewish people are here to say, we're not going to stop. We're going to keep on keeping on like we always have. We're an eternal people with a majestical destiny. Tonight we have Ishai Fleischer with us, the director of Israel National Radio. He served as a platoon sergeant in the Israeli army, in the paratroopers. Please, everyone, welcome Ishai Fleischer as he shares his heart and his story with you all.
Shalom, everybody. It's an honor to be with you here on Yom HaZikaron. I wrote an essay about some of my experiences, and I thought that it would be appropriate to share it with you, because it's on this very topic. And it's called Zikaron, which means memory. If you didn't know, it means memory. In March of 1995, my friends and I were drafted to the Israeli Army. We had passed some grueling tests and were accepted to the paratrooper brigade, the Tzanchanim. The image of the Red Berets liberating the Western Wall was fused into our psyches, and more than anything, we wanted to serve our country honorably and to the best of our abilities. 6 painful months of basic training were ahead of us. In this period of time, our minds and bodies were converted from civilian use and became the property of the IDF. We learned to push the envelope of our individual human capacity and to harness the great strength inherent in an indivisible platoon. All this time, we kept our sights to the final day of basic training, in which we would hike 86 kilometers in utter silence, full infantry gear, up to Givat Tachmoshet, that's Ammunition Hill in Jerusalem, where many paratroopers had perished in 1967, and there we would receive our very own Red Berets and finally be inducted into the ranks of the paratroopers. However, one fine day in May, barely 3 months after we began basic training, our pit bull-like sergeant major came into our barracks with a large box. We had no clue what its contents were. The sergeant major proceeded to open the box and, much to our surprise, unveiled Red Berets for each one of us in the platoon. "You don't deserve to be paratroopers yet," he told us, "but tomorrow you will leave the base and think of yourselves as full-fledged Tzanchanim for one day. You will not get to keep these," he added, "but wear them with pride and respect." Well, the next day was Yom HaZikaron, Memorial Day, and the whole of the paratrooper brigade, thousands of men, would be released for one day to attend one of the many commemorations of fallen soldiers that take place in our tiny nation. Each one of us was given precise directions to the cemetery, and a plot number was also given to us. We were told that the plot number corresponded to the grave of a fallen paratrooper. We were ordered to stand next to that grave and next to the family of a young man who was once just like ourselves, wearing our Red Berets as he once did, and in a sense, to represent his memory and his soul. Well, the next day, I had luck hitchhiking. I reached the gates of the cemetery about an hour early, and the place was quiet and serene. The large space echoed silence, and only birds chirped in the large trees. Nature had overtaken this resting place, and many of the walls were covered in ivy. I tried listening to the graves and heard no cries of pain, no last words, and no fear of death. The dead, it seemed to me, had made peace with their fate. They were no longer bitter at having fallen so young. Alone amongst the dead I stood, a bit in a daydream under the sun. But soon people began to arrive, and I straightened my stance, made sure my beret was on right. I was nervous at meeting the family I was assigned to. Who would they be? How would they react to me? Will they cry next to me? Will they ask me who I am? I thought about my own mother and her reservations about my army service. Soon, I spotted a family of 3, a father, mother, and a son, and they were heading in my general direction. It was indeed my family. They greeted me kindly, and the father asked me who I was and where did I serve. The mother, who obviously had been through this before, brought out some fruits and water to nourish the soldier with the Red Beret standing in front of her. And though she looked at me, I could see that her mind was far away and that I was but a painful reminder of her longing to nourish her own child. As the somber ceremony began, once again I eyed my surroundings and saw families standing by graves all around me. Interspersed among them were other Red Berets representing the fallen of the Tzanchanim. At this moment, more than any other, tears welled up inside, for I realized that this was more than a personal tragedy of one fallen Tzanchan, but rather the day that all of Israel remembered the men who had laid down their lives in the effort to build a home for the Jewish people, a home that we had lost so long ago. While the living cried, the dead now rested eternally in the bosom of Eretz Yisrael. Well, My adopted family was now in tears, and the horns blared and reverberated throughout the cemetery, signifying the moment of silence and memory that had finally come. In that one moment, I thought of gratitude. Gratitude. I'm so thankful to you, fallen Sanchan, fallen Jew, fallen brother. Without you, my parents would have no place to run to from the chokehold of the Soviet Union. Without you, Jews of the world would never have shelter. And without you, I would not stand here today wearing this uniform with a red beret that did not yet belong to me. Suddenly, it became clear to me that the dead had come back to life in the form of a new generation of young soldiers who stood on the graves on the land which God had promised them, the land which they had fought and died for. Happened to be that Shimon Peres was speaking, and he finished speaking at the ceremony, and it was over. The family thanked me for coming. They looked down onto their son's grave, and God only knows what went through their minds. While they walked away slowly, the mother leaning on her husband, noticeably weaker than when she entered, I would probably never see them again. Shalom, Ima. Shalom, Abba, I said to myself. 7 months after this story took place, Tom Kareen was one of our company commanders, and he was killed in a Hezbollah ambush. Also in that altercation, Yoav Be'er, a friend of mine in Platoon 2, lost an eye and a leg. Tom Kareen and I did not get along too well throughout most of the service. However, a few weeks before his death, as I stood at an overlook guard post, I saw him from a distance leading other soldiers while he carried a communications radio on his back. And he saw me too. And from that distance, he waved broadly with a big smile as if to say, "Shalom, friend, there is peace between us." That was the last I saw him. When he was killed, the battalion commander came to speak to us. He shared our sadness, but he told us not to cry at the funeral. He said, "The enemy should not see you weeping like babies in front of the cameras. We are an army, and death is part of it." And I knew that he was right. Tom was buried in the soil of his home kibbutz, Ginosaur, that's on the shores of the Sea of Galilee, the Kinneret, and it was the most beautiful cemetery I'd ever seen. It was hard to fight back tears at the funeral, as per our order, especially when Tom's fiance eulogized her dead man with such warm words and tears. Today's the day of memory and the time for those tears.
There are two little boys. Right now there should be 2 and 4. Their names are Gilad and Yoav, and they will not have a father that will be able to teach them how to ride a bike, how to learn to the Torah portion for their bar mitzvah, to send them off to the army, to bless them under the chuppah of their wedding canopy. But what Gilad and Yoav Klein will have, they will always know that their Abba, that their father, is a hero of Israel and is engraved on the hearts of every Jew in the world. Roei Klein was a highly decorated officer in the Israeli army. Everyone said he was tremendously admired and he was revered and respected. He was a fierce fighter, but at the same time, in his personality, he was gentle and compassionate. He was an accomplished musician, and he was a Torah scholar. During the Second Lebanon War, Roei volunteered to take his unit on a very dangerous mission into Bint Jebel, Lebanon. They found themselves in an alleyway in a very difficult position, surrounded by a Hezbollah ambush, and a grenade was lobbed right among his fellow soldiers. And in a split-second decision of unimaginable courage, Roei Klein lunged on top of that grenade, and he mustered the last breath to say, "Shema Yisrael, Adonai Eloheinu, Adonai Echad. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one." The mission and the purpose of the Jewish people. He sacrificed his life, not only for his soldiers around him, but for all of us. Roei Klein has given a generation of people who are losing faith in our future and in our leaders. He's given us hope, and he's given us something to believe in. Please watch his story.
ממש כשהשחר מתחיל להפציע בחושך האחרון, רואים מדווח לי בקשר שהוא נתקל מאחור.
מרחביה למעשה יוצא יחד עם אחות שלו, באיגוף לכיוון נקודת המחבלים. שם הוא נתקל בחומה ולמעשה הוא נפגע. קליין לוקח כוח נוסף ויוצא לכיוון מרחביה כדי לחלץ אותו. כשקליין נכנס פנימה הוא מזהה את מרחביה פצוע. שניים או שלושה לוחמים שנמצאים לידו פותחים אלונקה ושמים את עמיחי על האלונקה. תוך כדי שהם מרימים את האלונקה, נזרק רימון לכיוון הכוח. רועי מזהה את הרימון הזה, קופץ עליו.
בהחלטה של אלפית שנייה, הוא פשוט קופץ על הרימון, נפגע ממנו.
מצליח ככה להציל את אלה שהיו לידו והרימו בדיוק את האלונקה.
פתאום אני זוכר שמע ישראל כזה, בכוונה. כאילו, שמע ישראל, השם, אלוקנו, השם, אחד. ככה ממש בכוונה, כאילו, ממש כמו בסיפורים.
I remember the things you said at the Medal of Honor ceremony when you were only 26.
הזמן של המערב זה רק היומיים שלפני ההתקלות, שאנחנו בעצם יושבים ומחכים ובעצם לא קורה שום דבר, אז זה חודשים. כלומר, בעצם רוב הפעילות היא פעילות כזאת, שיושבים במערב שעות אגבי שעות, שלושה ימים, ארבעה ימים, ולא קורה שום דבר בעצם. זה קורה, האמת, לא מתרגשים יותר מדי. זה קורה, פועלים בצורה די טכנית, על פי מה שמתרגלים באימונים הרבה מאוד. ומנסים לשמור על קור רוח, לא מתרגשים יותר מדי. מה שאתה מרגיש בסוף זה הרצון כן לעמוד במשימה, שבסוף המשימה זה נגזרת של ערכים מסוימים, כמו באמת אהבת העם והארץ, ובאמת תרומה למדינה.
שמע ישראל, אדוני אלוהינו, אדוני אחד.
כשהוא חוזר לצבא, הרבה פעמים רציתי להגיד לו, תשמור על עצמך. אבל הרגשתי שזה לא שייך. התביישתי להגיד לו. כי ידעתי שהוא יגיד לי, מה לשמור על עצמי? אני הולך לצבא, אני... הרבה פעמים הייתי אומרת לו, תשמור על אחרים, תשמורו אחד על השני. דברים כאלה. גם בפעם האחרונה שהוא יצא.
ענה, ענה בכל. תולת ימינך, תתיר צרועה. קם אל רינה, עמך סגבנו, תארנו, תארנו רע. ענה בכוח. גדולת ימינך, תתיר צרומה. קבל רינת עמך, סגבנו, תארנו רומה. נגיבור, ראשי יפותך, כבבא שורם, רחם תארם, רחמי צדקתך.
I miss you, my beloved brother. I got to know you again through all of the people whose lives you've touched. Everyone I met was convinced that he knew the real Roi. You invested your all in everything you did. I understand now that you're no longer just my little brother. Dad, Mom, Noah, Sarah, and your kids Gilad and Yoav now share you with everyone. Suddenly many people know you, who you were, what happened. You've become everyone's hero. And I'm left only with memories, pictures, and pain.
Tonight we have the honor of sharing with the world and sharing with you tonight, Rebbetzin Esther Youngreis. Born in Hungary, she's a Holocaust survivor. If there's anyone that knows the pain of the Jewish people, the essence of the soul of Israel, if there's someone that we need to hear on Yom HaZikaron on how to deal with that pain, it's Rebbetzin Esther Youngreis. She's been a columnist for decades, the author of bestsellers like The Committed Life, The Committed Marriage, Soul on Fire. Her newest book, Life is a Test, has already inspired people across the globe. She's the founder and director of Hineni, one of the most powerful Kiruv organizations in the world. Kiruv that brings the Jewish people closer to themselves, closer to each other, closer to God. So please, everyone, give us a warm welcome as we welcome Rebbetzin Esther Youngreis. So Rebbetzin, you lived through the days of the Holocaust, through all of the wars of Israel, through all of the terror attacks. How are we supposed to deal with the pain? What are we supposed to do as the Jewish people with all of our painful history? How are we supposed to relate to all the pain that we've been through?
The pain of the Jewish people is different than the pain of any other nation. חבלי יהודי כחבלי לידה של אישה. The suffering of the Jewish people is like the suffering of a woman who is about to give birth. On Tisha B'Av, when we mourn our holy temple, we have in the keynote a beautiful song that we sing. Eli Tzion ve'areha kmo isha b'tzireha. Weep for Zion and for her cities like you would weep for a woman in labor. For she knows that even as she is filled with pain, she knows that very soon she will see new life. So we the Jewish people never forget our vision, our hope to see Yerushalayim rebuilt. We know there is a higher plan, a higher purpose. We understand that we are living in Ikveta Mashiach right now, in the time which is called the footsteps of Messiah. We understand that this is not the end. Our suffering has a purpose, a goal. And there is a God above us who leads us. And we are going to see the Geula very shortly. And we never forget that. When I was a little girl in Bergen-Belsen, I knew that we the Jewish people would survive. How did I know that? Because I was nurtured on the milk of Emunah, on the milk of faith. In Egypt, how did we survive Egypt? When you think about it, how did we survive that Galut, that terrible exile? How did a man and a woman have three children like Aaron, Miriam, and Moshe? How did you have children like that in Egypt, in one family? You know how? The father of these three children was Amram. Amram, an exalted nation. Can you understand this? In the Auschwitz of Egypt, to call a child exalted nation? What was the name of the mother? Yocheved. Kavod for Ka. Give honor to God. Understand that. In the Auschwitz of Egypt, to be able to say, we shall give honor to our God. And that's what kept us going. We never forgot. From Egypt to Bergen-Belsen to Auschwitz. And today we have to deal with our own terror, with our own terrible pain. Today's Yom HaZikaron. We remember our fallen soldiers. But those fallen soldiers gave us Eretz Israel. Look at this
pin that I'm wearing. This is the pin that I always wear. Wherever you see me, you will never see me without this medallion. Do you know how this was born? My husband, of blessed memory, Zichat Tzadik Kadosh Livracha, Harav Meshulam Halevi Young Rice, was not only the most amazing rabbi who loved Am Yisrael and was filled with Torah and Chesed, but he was also an artist. So right after Melchemet Yom HaKippurim, I felt that we have to do something for the many wounded and of course for the families of those who fell. So I asked my husband if he would design a sikkah, a medallion, with the name of Hineni, that we could present to all our psu'im, our wounded soldiers. I came to Eretz Israel with these sikkot, with these medallions. And my first program was in Tel HaShomer Hospital. I gave out these medallions to all the soldiers who were wounded. And then one of the nurses came over to me and said, could I visit a soldier who was burned in a tank? He was in a very poor condition. He couldn't participate. I said, of course. Come into his room. He was covered like a mummy. And I placed this medallion on his night table. And I said to him, I'm coming from the States to express honor and blessings to you in the name of all your Jewish brethren. And he said something which I didn't understand. So I said to the nurse, what did he say? And he said, Rebbetzin, you don't want to know. I said, but I do want to know. So I asked him again, tell me, what did you say? And he said something not complimentary. And he said, I should take the medallion and take it back to the States. I understood. He was bitter. He was upset. I said, no, I'm not going to do that. I'm going to leave this medallion over here, and one day you are going to fall in love. And this will be my engagement gift to you and to your bride. And suddenly he burst out crying. And he said, I'm not a soldier anymore. I'm not a man anymore. No girl would ever want to marry me. I said, you're right. You're right. You are not a man. You are Malach Hashem. You are an angel of God. So he started to mock. He said, me? An angel of God? I said, yes. You know why? Because it's written in the Torah that when Hashem made the promise to our father Abraham that this land would belong to us eternally, then Abraham said, Bame Eda, how do I know? It's very difficult to understand our father's question. Abraham was the paradigm of faith. Me'amin b'Hashem, he believed in God. He believed in faith. He believed. So how could Hashem have listened to this? Bame Eda, how do I know? God forbid. Our father Abraham never doubted. So if God promises, isn't that sufficient? How could he ask such a question? But Abraham Avinu saw in Ruach HaKodesh that a time would come when the children, his descendants, would forget the Torah. And he asked a haftacha, he asked a promise from God. Lamrut hakol, despite everything, the afal pikin, despite everything, this land must belong to us. Give me a promise, Hashem, even if my children will forget who they are. And Hashem said, korbanot, sacrifices. So I said to the soldier, nachon hadavar, you are correct. Yafeh amarta, you were speaking correctly. You are not a man anymore. You are an angel of God through whose sacrifice this land was given to us. And Be'ezrat Hashem, we have returned to our land after almost 2,000 years. Who would have believed it? We are a generation that has seen the fulfillment of prophecy. But we have so beset with problems. We are in such turmoil that we do not understand. We have seen so many miracles right before our very eyes. Who would have believed this? A nation coming home after almost 2,000 years of Holocaust, pogroms, suffering. With our very eyes, we have seen the fulfillment of prophecy. Haftachat Hashem le'amo, the promise of God to His people. Lord, the fasnu et hapele, we didn't quite understand the miracle because we have too many problems and there is no one to open our eyes. So yes, I was in Bergen-Belsen. Yes, I lived through that. But I never forgot who I was. Amram, we are an exalted nation. Kavod Hashem, to give honor to God. So you cannot lose your faith. You cannot lose your hope. And just look at us. Just look at us. Look at every battle that Israel fought. Miracle after miracle. Who would have believed it? Just consider Milchamet Sheshet Hayamim. You know, we don't have time to go through all the stories, but has there ever been a battle that was fought in 6 days? In 6 days? Why 6 days? In Stam Mikveh B'Historia Shel Am Yisrael, there is no such a thing as a coincidence in the history of the Jewish people. Mikveh is a kara mehashem. Mikveh means it happened from God. So what does that mean? 6 days, the seventh day was ready to come. And what is the seventh day? Yom Shekula Shabbat. Our Lord Tafasna Tapela, we didn't get the mystery, the miracle. Hashem was calling us and we didn't understand. So in every generation we see this and Hashem is waiting for us to come home to Him. And consider this, friends. Here is Chodesh Iyar. We are in the month of Iyar now. And a good Chodesh to everybody. And consider that Yom HaZikaron, Yom Yerushalayim, and Yom HaAtzmaut are all in the month of Iyar. Why? Why? What do we learn from this? What's the limud? What's the message? What's the message? Iyar is Rosh Tevot, is the initials of Avot, of our fathers, and Imaot, of our mothers. Aleph, Avraham, Yud, Yitzchak, Yud, Yaakov, Resh, Rachel, Imenu. Why? Because it is to these people that Hashem made the promise, an unconditional promise that this land will forever belong to us, to Rachel, Imenu. Kol Berama Nishma. A voice is heard in Rama, high above. Rachel mevaka al baneha. Rachel is weeping for her children. And Hashem says to her, Mine kolech mi bechi. Cease your weeping. Enaich mi dima. Wipe your tears. Yischa lepulatech. There is a reward for your labor. Veshavu banim likvolam. The children shall come home to their borders. Iyav. It all happened in Iyav. To remind us. So I said all these things to that soldier. And I said to him, I'm leaving the sikkah. I'm leaving this medallion with you. And one day you will give it to the girl that you will choose to marry. You will see. I left. I came back. A year later, and my first speech on that occasion was in a Beit Havra, in a recuperation center for soldiers. After my speech, they wheeled up a soldier in a kisei galgalim in a wheelchair to present me with flowers. And he says to me, Rabbanit, at lo mekira oti? Rebetzin, you don't recognize me? And I look at him and I said, you are very familiar to me. I say that all the time when I meet people because, you know, it's impossible for me to remember everybody, but I don't want to hurt people, so I always say, and forgive me for this, you look very familiar, please help me. So he said, Nala Hakir at Kalati, please meet my bride. And I look at this lovely young girl, and she's wearing the sikkah. So that's the story of the Jewish people. That's the story of our suffering. It's not without purpose. It's not without a goal. So we can take it. Why can we take it? Because there is a reason for it. There is a God above us. And if anybody should know it, it is our generation. We have witnessed the miracles. But we have forgotten who we are. We are so beset with problems that we have forgotten. So tonight, let us remember. Because that's the only way to remember Yom HaZikaron. Our soldiers did not sacrifice in vain. We have returned to our land after almost 2,000 years. Our forefathers just dreamt of this. It was a chazon, it was a vision. And we have been privileged to witness it. Every morning when we get up, we should sing Hallel to Hashem. Thank you, God. Thank you, God. Kumu lavodat hapore, get up and worship your Creator. So we don't have suffering. We have a vision, we have a purpose.
So, with the last few moments that we have, what would be your one message to all of the Jewish people around the world on Yom HaZikaron?
My message on Yom HaZikaron would be the same as on every day. Every morning, towards the end of our tefillot, we have a special prayer. I don't know if you ever paid attention to it. It's at the end of a Wall of Zion. And we say to Hashem, we say to God, Shalom niga lirik. Please God help that we shouldn't have labored for naught. Shalom nilid labahala. We shouldn't have been born for no reason. Each and every person has a mission in life. There is no one in this world who is exactly like you or is exactly like me. Hashem created each and every one of us custom made. Hanushama shenatata bituharahi, the soul that you gave me is pure. Ata yotzata, you created. Ata nefachta bi, you breathed it into me. So you have to understand who you are. You have a mission. You belong to Am Yisrael. You have a goal. Psych yourself up to it. Don't allow the craziness of the world to get to you. Remember, you are Am Yisrael. We survived Hitler, we shall survive Ahmadinejad, we shall survive all of them. This is our history, because God is leading our history. And if you would know, if you would understand Torah, you would see that everything is written. Do you know that in Yalkut Shimoni, there is a whole passage about the time when the king of Iran, the king of Paraz is Iran, Persia, is going to have a weapon that will terrify the entire world. And Hashem says, don't be afraid, my children. All this I do because this is the beginning of the days of Mashiach. Am I telling you a story? You know in your heart it's the truth. Otherwise you wouldn't be here. Otherwise, we wouldn't be here. I mean, just look at me. A child from Bergen-Belsen speaking to you in Yerushalayim. I mean, do we understand that? You know, some years ago, if I just conclude with this story by me, I was called by the President, President Bush, to represent the United States at the Yad Vashem dedication. And it was an awesome privilege. We had seven people representing the President and the United States. I was one of the seven. We flew in a special plane, which was presented to us by the President. the government's plane, on the way back to Andrews Air Force Base. The Honorable Fred Seidman, who's head of the Washington Holocaust Museum, came over to me and he said to me, "Robertson, do you know where you are?" And I look at him and I said, "Fred, I would like to think I know where I am." And he said, no, I mean, look at the map, Robertson, charting our course. Now look at the map. We were flying over Germany. He said to me, "Robertson, think about it. You, a child of Bergen-Belsen, flying over Germany in a plane that belongs to the United States government, to the President of the United States, and you are coming from Jerusalem." I said, "Fred, I have never forgotten. I think about it all the time, every day. The miracle of Am Yisrael. And to all of you who are here tonight, and to all those who are listening all over the world, never forget. We are Mamlechet Kohanim, a priestly kingdom. We survived every generation, every century, every tyrant. We saw empires come and empires go. And we are here. Hineni, we are here. And we shall be here. And we shall welcome Mashiach. Never be afraid. We are Jews. And there is a God above us who guides our history." Thank you so much, dear friends. Thank you so much. God bless you all. Thank you so much. It means so much to me to be here with you in Yerushalayim and HaKodesh, and I thank you for your beautiful Jewish hearts. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
The Israeli leadership in the past has said, "We're tired of fighting. We're tired of winning." And we're here tonight to say that's not true. We're not weak and we're not tired. We are eternal. The sacrifices that our beloved soldiers made have not gone in vain. Their sacrifices brought us to where we are today. Their Mesirut Nefesh, their self-sacrifice is our guide. It's the source of our strength. It's our inspiration. Their sacrifice reminds all of us that we're one people, that we're one family. Their sacrificing their lives reminds us why we're living our lives. Tonight, our hearts go out to all of the families that have been left behind. All of the families of the terror victims, all of the families that lost their children in war. Their pain is our pain, and their loss is our loss. May Hashem see the unity of the Jewish people and hear our cry and redeem us now. Shalom from Jerusalem. Yeah.